what goes on. Thank you for letting us be ourselves. So don't mind me if I repeat myself. These simple rhymes be good for your health. To keep them crime rhymes on the shelf. Live, love, life like you just don't care. 5,000 leaders never scared. Bring the noise, it's the moment they fear. Get up, celebrate for that day.
Take your mark and tighten up your prosthetic. It's Friday, we're live, and it's time for the last leg. Tonight on the show, we showcase the World Para Athletics Championships, bring you up to date on all the Wimbledon action, and check out a media Stormzy. Plus, we'll be joined on the couch by Paralympian Liam Malone, Parasports superfan Johnny Vegas, and comedian Roisin Conaty on the show that always separates the wheat from the chaff. Welcome to the last leg of the show that does to the news what Rob Beckett appeared to do to a horse last week. With me on the couch, as always, are the pride of Dartmoor, Josh Whittacombe, and the man who heard a 1 trillion ton block of ice had broken off from Antarctica and immediately ordered a 2 trillion ton gin and tonic. I was never going to get that right. Alex Booker! Now, the World Para Athletics Championship started today, and we are going to cover it for you later in the show. But before we do, okay, I've got a confession to make. Something happened last weekend that I'm very embarrassed about. I got sunburnt. in England. I got sunburnt in England.
Best news ever.
It looked like this.
Do you know the most embarrassing thing? You were inside when it happened.
Do you know why and the reason it happened, this is the worst... the reason it happened is that I, until last weekend, refused to believe that I could actually get sunburnt in England. So I would never put on suntan cream, because I thought, it can't. I grew up in Australia, there's no way your sun can burn me.
But it's just so nice to know that karma exists.
People on Twitter thought it was... Sorry?
In the form of a red patch.
People on Twitter thought it was hilarious. A letter said, you know it's the same sun, right?
I'm not saying that you deserved it, but you deserved it. You were so smug the other week with your sun tips.
So smug. Yep.
You were so smug, I don't even think you can give sun tips anymore.
No,
so
really.
I'm going to give them. Brooker's heat tips. Don't listen to Hills. Brooker's heat tips.
Well, the thing is, then people then started sending me their own sunburn pictures on Twitter, including this
one.
What
are you? So you are asking people to... That's like some weird fetish test. Please send me your pictures of you sunburnt.
No, I didn't ask. People just said... So there was that guy.
Yeah.
Humpty Dumpty.
I mean, that guy said, I can't believe this happened in Manchester, and someone else tweeted, yeah, we can, you were wearing a vest. Thank God it wasn't a string vest. This one is the worst of them all.
Do you remember those old ring pulls? When you
It's like I've spent a fair bit of time in hospitals. Yeah. I've seen some shit, but that's minging. Yeah.
Just want to say that it is a serious thing. Skin cancer is a terrible thing, and that is the beginning of it. So
that
should
be the new advert.
Just that
the
guy's
sun
head.
Cream.
Yeah.
Fuck all the other adverts, just a picture of that. Where's sun cream?
As always, we will do our best to answer your big questions this week. You can tweet them to us at the last league. Use the hashtag #IsItOK. For example, is it OK that a 15-year-old work experience kid called Eddie took over Southern Rail's Twitter account this week? Yes, it is. Is it OK that he was immediately inundated with questions like, would you rather fight one horse-sized duck or 100 duck-sized horses? Yes, it is. Is it OK that Eddie then won the internet by responding to questions like that with answers like, oh, 100 duck-sized horses, because a horse-sized duck would be pretty scary? It was an amazing piece of public relations, especially when you consider that 2 days later, the operator of Southern Rail was fined more than £13 million for repeated disruption due to industrial action.
It was amazing. It was really brilliant. I mean, obviously, it's weird, because normally if you were going, I'm just tweeting a 15-year-old boy, that would be considered very weird.
Yes.
But people go, I'm just tweeting a 15-year-old boy. Well, what is wrong with you?
I think he's going to... I reckon he's going to go far, because, like, for a 15-year-old lad to have access to the internet all day...
Yeah.
..and just do work...
John Elliott said, can we get Ask Eddie to answer this week's Is It OK questions? Yes, we can, John. Would you all please welcome the star of Southern Rail's Twitter feed, Eddie! And can I just say, for those of you at home, this is not an actor, this is not an extra, this is the Eddie who is in charge of Southern Rail Twitter. Well done for making it on time.
Thank you.
oh, that's a very unfair joke to make onto a 15-year-old boy.
Why? He did very well. He could have been delayed. We have some... Josh, do you want to put the earphones on him? Because being 15, he's not allowed to hear bad language.
Oh, OK. So the moment these are on...
Yeah.
So I can say what the fuck I like, and then if I take them off, it's fine.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
Can you hear me, Eddie?
Well, they definitely work.
Cool. There you go.
So he can't hear me.
No.
Do you want a beer, Eddie?
You can tweet your "Is it OK?" questions to him at the last leg. Use the hashtag #EddieIsItOK. Oh, we were so happy with that one.
Yeah.
Eddie, and you're going to be singing it now. Is it OK, Eddie? Eddie, is it OK?
The end of the show's exciting because he's fighting a horse-sized duck.
He'll answer them for you throughout the show. Now, as we mentioned, the World Para Athletics Championships are being held in London this year. It's expected to pull in the biggest audience in the event's history. The best of the best in para athletics are going to come together for the first time since Rio to find out which superhumans have become a little bit more super. This is a huge deal for para sport. It is never... The Para Athletics World Championships have never had this kind of coverage. I think it's 20 countries around the world. It's going to be 30,000 people on Sunday. It's an enormous thing for it this year.
And even the Americans are doing coverage.
Yes.
Now, so I know, because before they used to bin it off, didn't they?
Yes. Yeah, they've really jumped on board. I think because they want to prove that they're all about it now because they want the 2024.
Although, I must say, if Donald Trump watches it, I dread to think what he's going to say about it. Trump live tweeting the para athletics.
Look, if you love para sport and you want to keep it on TV, all you have to do is just keep watching over the next 10 days. It's going to be great. Already, earlier tonight, Hannah Cockcroft raced in the 100 metres in the wheelchair. Out the audience, we all came in here a little bit early to watch the race. Here's how it went down.
That's my girl.
Now listen to the cheer for one of the pinup girls of British para athletics, Hannah Cockcroft. Away they go. A good start from Adenigan on the far side and briefly headed Cockcroft. Cockcroft is starting to come back to now, but it was a blistering start from Adenigan. But here comes Cockcroft coming steaming through. Tremendous performance up to the line. World record of a brilliant summer.
You know what, the support in here is phenomenal. Coming out and hearing your name shouted quite so many times is... oh wow, we haven't had that since London 2012, so it was quite emotional. It was amazing.
We have Hannah live from the stadium right now. Hannah, are you there? Can you hear us?
I am indeed, I can hear you.
Hey, congratulations, firstly, on behalf of all
of us.
But secondly, that bit at the beginning before the race when the camera came onto your face, were you doing a bit of blue steel?
Yeah, of course. You've got to flirt a bit with the audience, haven't you? So, you know, I can't look like I'm having a great time. It's pretty scary sitting on that track. Show it.
I mean, was it flirty? Because it looked, I mean, it looked angry.
Oh, do I look angry? I don't know. It's not angry, it's, you know what, it's a game face. I'm there to focus, I'm there to do a job. Yeah. I'm not there to wave at the crowds and have a good time until the end, you know, when the job's done. So I think it worked quite well. It's my signature move.
It looked like you had a sigh of relief when you crossed the finish line, was it?
Yeah, a little bit. You know, Carrie's been pushing really well this year. She's PB'd in every 100-metre race she's done. And I've been struggling with a bit with the sprints the last few years. That a sub-17 has been haunting me. So I'm getting closer. So just coming out today was about, I knew Carrie had the strongest start, and for me it was about getting a good top speed and kind of trying to get past her, and thankfully it went well.
Well, congratulations. Also, I mean, she's been studying for her GCSEs at the moment, so, you know, maybe once she can actually focus, she might take you down.
Oh, rude.
To be fair, she's in charge of Southern Rail's Twitter next week.
Hannah Cockcroft, congratulations on the first British gold of the Games.
Thank you.
Channel 4 is covering all the events for you over the next week, and we will be previewing the action later in the show. But here's a tip for any sports broadcaster. Make sure you know what the competitors look like. Ben Wright said, is it OK that friend of the show Stormzy has apparently signed for Manchester United? Now, as footballer Romelu Lukaku signed with Man United this week, an Irish newspaper printed a gigantic headline with a picture of grime artist Stormzy. Now, anyone who knows football knows that Stormzy could never replace Lukaku, mainly because he's way too big for his boots. That's a very niche joke. The newspaper was roundly criticised. Stormzy himself took to Twitter saying, I don't find none of this funny.
It was, yeah, I mean, it turns out that putting work experience people in charge can go wrong as well as right.
Just for anyone from the Irish Herald who is watching, yep, that little emoji in Stormzy's tweet, that's not Lukaku or Stormzy.
It's good for the heads up. You used to be a journalist. Who's to blame?
Society, really, Adam. Society that thinks casual racism is okay. No, it's probably, do you know what? It was probably somebody who's, they've got it from like a picture website, and it's probably just been captioned up wrong. And
so then
I'd have guessed.
So it's probably not the paper's fault, it's probably the fault of the website that has all the pictures. So someone's just searched Lukaku, that's come up, and they've gone, yep, fine.
Yeah, I'd like to think that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Although, and also though, but either way, when you look at that photo, look how, like, you'd think he would have looked happier signing for Man United than in that photo. Surely, you know, I mean, that's just a face for United.
That's a face that goes, I'm not worth 75 million.
But there are studies that suggest people are more likely to make this kind of mistake when it's a race they're unfamiliar with, which means the more minorities we see in the media, the less likely this is to happen. Or we could just try to redress the balance by showing the wrong pictures of white people for the rest of the show. By the way, happy birthday this week to Patrick Stewart and Harrison Ford. It was a bad week for casual racism as Ross McClellan asked, is it OK that Tory MP Anne-Marie Morris just casually said the N-word during an interview? Now, this, of course, refers to a phrase that was used this week by a Tory MP from Devon by the name of Anne-Marie Morris. There she is there with Boris Johnson. Morris described a Brexit deal using a phrase that we've talked about it. I don't think we can say it on the show.
No, I don't. I honestly think if you say that phrase,
yeah,
the only person that leaves here with their job will be the kid in the headphones.
I mean, that is the question. Can you say the N-word when you're reprimanding someone else for using it?
Why don't you have a go? Just dip your toe in the water.
No, I've learned that that's how you lose a foot.
But no.
Is that how you lost it?
That's how I lost my foot, dipping my toe in the water.
It's absolutely horrendous.
Yeah.
And it says something that there would be, like, members of the DUP thinking, tell you what, we've gone into coalition with a party with some very outdated views from their MPs.
No, so we're not going to say it. Here's what happened. Anne-Marie Morris described the UK leaving the EU without a deal as the N-word in the woodpile. Now, this is a weird phrase. It's thought to refer to a time when black slaves would hide in woodpiles while escaping from slave owners. According to Wikipedia, this phrase now means a fact of considerable importance that is not disclosed, something suspicious or wrong. I'd just like to point out how scared I was while Googling that phrase this week.
Mate, you just want to count. I'm always on private mode.
It's a weird thing, because I thought, well, I need to know what it is, but I'm going to have to enter it into... And I was at home, I considered hiding under the sheets, and then I knew that was going to make it worse.
It's astonishing. I just find it utterly baffling,
yeah,
that she has chosen that phrase. It's utterly... It's so insane. Because there's so... Also, there is so many phrases.
Yep.
I mean, the elephant in the room is she didn't use the phrase elephant in the room.
To be honest, I think that is a slightly different But and look, I know how hard it is to get to, you know, to go for a reference, and it's very easy to just go with something you knew since you were a teenager.
But that's
not... Do you not think?
No, not really. Like, I don't still answer the phone and go, what's
up? That is bullshit! You do! It's not about the age of the reference. It's not. We're not having a go because she's used an old reference.
No.
If she'd used opal fruits, we wouldn't give a shit. Like, the N-word isn't Nokia. Like, the problem is that it's an offensive word. That's yes. The problem.
Well, and politicians have been condemning the use of, not the word, but this phrase since 1968 when Anne-Marie Morris was 11. There really is no excuse for her using it.
No.
I mean, since 1993, the woodpile phrase has been used, here's the weird thing, 12 times by various politicians, since 1993. And the score at the moment is once by Labour, once by a Lib Dem, 10 times by the Tories. Which begs the question, why do the Tories keep saying this phrase? Has anyone checked the Downing Street garden? Do they have a woodpile?
It's incredible that it's been used so much
by
Tories. Like, they're more together on this than what they were on the dementia tax.
I'll tell you what's incredible. I'd have bet my mortgage on the fact that UKIP would have won that league.
Even Quentin Tarantino right now is going, lads, can we stop using the word? Anne-Marie Morris apologised for any offence caused, which is what you say when you don't actually think you were being offensive. And her local Conservative Association described it as, quote, a slip of the tongue.
It's not a slip of the tongue. A slip of the tongue is when you accidentally called a teacher mum. Yeah. This is racist.
I had a slip of the tongue last week. Grow up. I was on... I was texting my girlfriend while I was on the phone to EDF Energy and I finished the call by saying, love you. And I don't love them, although their prices are very competitive.
Yeah. Which is how you finish the call to your girlfriend. It is interesting, in the week that the Paralympics kicked off in London, PRSD asked, is it OK that one in four Brits admit to avoiding conversations with disabled people? Now, according to an article this week, fear of causing offence and feeling uncomfortable were cited as the reasons for not speaking to disabled people.
Yeah, I also think, part of me does think that one in four people that avoids it is because they're in a disabled toilet and there's a disabled person outside knocking to get in. But I don't think, you know, it's not great, you know. I'd like to think, you know, it's not going to get to the stage where, you know, we're going to find ourselves going into disabled toilets and pulling the emergency cord just as someone comes to talk to us.
And look, go on.
But I just...
Yeah, that's fine, just ignore me, guys. Unbelievable.
Sorry, mate, this is, our chat. But I genuinely, you know, I'd like to think that for most people, inherently as a society, we want to be polite. Yeah. Social interactions are awkward. You talk to someone on the tube and they look like you've just coughed a disease on them. Do you know what I mean? But, you know, and that's not just with disabled people.
Yeah.
And I think that there are people, they do get nervous because they are trying to say the right thing. I mean, some people are pricks. Yeah. But, you know, there are, you know, I genuinely do believe that some people are just nervous. And I get nervous around other disabled.
You're not going to, you know, the odds are you're not going to say, unless, you're not going to say the wrong thing unless you say, can I have a go in your wheelchair? Like...
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, it would be really nice to know what you can and can't say, and since one in four Brits are so worried about what to say to disabled people, they avoid conversations, we've prepared this public service announcement.
Hello. Do you feel awkward when talking to a disabled? I know I do. So here's a few pointers. Oh, look, here comes one now. If you see someone in a wheelchair, crouch down and talk to them loudly, like they can't understand you. They love that.
Hello. How are you? Do you speak English?
Feel free to push them too. You don't even need to ask their permission.
Actually, I'm going the other way.
She loves it. Uh-oh, here's a dwarf. Remember to put them at ease by wearing your shoes on your knees. That's always hilarious. Why not ask them if they've got a riddle for you? And if you don't like where they're standing, just pop them somewhere else. They won't mind.
Get off me! Get off!
Go! Lovely stuff. And if you find yourself sitting next to someone with hand disabilities, just make jokes about them week after week after week, all to further your own career.
Oh, someone's got all fingers and thumbs. Small hand for this guy.
Honestly, I keep reporting him, but nobody's listening. If anyone cares, please help me.
That's the spirit. There you have it. Now you know how to talk to a disabled. Next week, I'll show you how to stay safe in the sun using this olive oil and this tin foil. That way, you'll really cook. Toodle-pip.
And, just in case you're in any doubt, don't do any of those things.
All right, let's bring out...
someone at home going, well, I'm glad I took notes. All right, let's bring out tonight's guests. One is a comedian who stars in the TV show Benidorm. The other is a comedian who is soon to star in her own show, Game Face. Would you please welcome Johnny Vegas and Roisin Conaty? Roisin, Johnny, welcome. This is Eddie over here. I'd say Eddie, Josh, can you get his attention? Can you just wave at Johnny and Roisin? Yeah, there you go.
It's almost like he heard you.
I don't think he did, to be honest. Now, Johnny, you were with us in Rio for the Paralympics last year.
Yeah.
You described the Paralympics as a game changer. Roisin's never seen the Paralympic Games before. Can you explain to her what's so great about parasports?
It was being part of something that you go in. I think you would watch on telly and go, oh, well done. And then when you get out there, you go, God almighty, this is like the most collaborative, inspiring.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? The stories behind, but isn't that the most competitively, fiercely, the way they speak about each other off the field. Everything about it was where you're going, I've never, outside of rugby league, been so immersed in sport.
Yeah.
Because athletics always put me off.
Why?
Because it was wankers at school. His dad was a lawyer. And these were people who came out and competed.
Do you know what? I think
they really competed, but took the time as well to talk to you. Do you know what I mean? You were in there.
Yeah. I mean, some disabled people are wankers, but...
Try working with them, mate. Try working with them.
Are you up?
I had a massive finger that was going to be lowered.
Roisin, right. Would you... will you go to some events over the next week?
I'd like to, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I watched that race earlier. It was incredible, so I got really invested.
It's one of those things that you don't really realise how much you're going to get into it until you actually go there and watch it live.
Yeah, I got pretty into it pretty fast.
I did. Yeah,
which is good, as it was 17 seconds.
Exactly. I'm all or nothing.
You don't know either until you come back. You actually don't know the impact until you come home. And you speak to people, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I find it's most difficult to talk about it without talking about it in some condescending tone, and it isn't. You're out there, you're getting hammered with the basketball team, you end up accidentally being a linesman, you go to watch a guy doing bowling, who's, you know what I mean, paralysed from the neck down, and I'm sat there going, arsehole. Why have you bowled that? And you can sit with him afterwards and go, mate, you need me as a coach.
Look, we're going to talk more about the para-athletics after the break, but it was good times and bad times for wheelchair users this week. In Dublin, this brave guy was crowd-surfed in a wheelchair at a Coldplay concert by a rapturous audience.
Maybe you heard they were going to do fiction and thought, I'll have a go on that.
In America, though, this hapless wheelchair user got a little too close to a startling moment. It's our favourite clip of the week.
Bagel, Terry. Put it in reverse, Terry. Put it in reverse. Oh, Lord. Oh, Steve. Ow, Lord. Oh, Steve. What are you doing, Terry?
We'll have more Last Week for you after the break as we look at the World Para Athletics Championships, and we welcome sprinter Liam Malone to the show. Plus, we want you to tweet your Is It OK questions to Southern Rail's work experience kid, Eddie. Tweet him at the Last Leg. Use the hashtag EddieIsItOK. We'll see you soon. We're still joined by Johnny Vegas and Roisin Conaty. We've got Eddie over there. He was Southern Rail's work experience kid, answering your questions on hashtag Eddie, is it OK? Richard Costello said, Eddie, is it OK? Are you Jimmy Carr's kid? I did hear him before the show laughing, and he did say, ho, ho, ho!
Eddie, those taxis, I think they might be fake, mate.
A big shout out to the Great British Wheelchair Rugby team who won the European Championships last week. And of course, the World Para Athletics Championships did start today. They will run until next Sunday. Before we go any further, I just want to say our thoughts are with the family and teammates of the UAE competitor Abdullah Hayaye, who suffered an accident in training and sadly passed away earlier in the week. Now, you can see all the sporting action on Channel 4 over the next 10 days. So far today, wheelchair racer Hannah Cockcroft won gold, set a world record, I believe. Co-racer Carrier Dennegan won silver. In the F32 club throw, Gemma Prescott from Great Britain took bronze. There has been an Australian gold, Cameron Crombie, in the F38 shot.
Could there be a more Australian name than Cameron Crombie?
Cameron Crombie!
Are you making up Australians?
Helping us out with our coverage this year is the New Zealand blade runner who won double gold at last year's Paralympic Games, Liam Malone. If you need a refresher course, this is why we all fell in love with him in Rio.
It's going to be close. Can he hold on? And he does so.
What are the emotions right now?
I'm not surprised. All I do is run around in circles and read books.
This is the first Games, I think, where athletes have inspired people to become Paralympians.
You mean in the sense where, you know, they're not chopping each other's legs off to become Paralympians?
No. Come Malone, hold on. He does a new Paralympic record.
It was kill or be killed. These boys are quick.
Would you please welcome Liam Malone?
Tell you
speed
what,
hugs.
That is an image makeover, isn't it?
Yeah, I know.
I thought you were about to talk me into being a Scientologist.
This is, and now I'm going to have to say, I mean, you and Eddie on the same couch, it looks like Eddie down the end there, is this like a Jeremy Kyle episode? Are you guys going to be reunited? Now, the big tragedy, of course, you're here to cover the Games because you're injured and you can't compete. What happened?
I had a stress fracture, so I was in crutches for around 4 months. And
right.
But that's fine. I would have loved to have competed in front of the UK crowd. It would have felt like a home crowd for me.
Yeah.
But I have my eyes on bigger things, and that's building a pair of blades to run faster than Usain Bolton.
What?
Yeah. You... No, I mean, not race against them, but that's what I'm working towards.
Your goal is to go faster than Usain Bolt.
100%.
How springy are these blades?
Very springy.
Here's what we're going to miss with the battle with you and Johnny Peacock. I mean, this was the moment. And this is one of those things, with one leg, Johnny's way out in front, but you came so close here at the end. That's Liam coming through. I reckon another 5 metres, it would have been very, very close. Johnny Peacock is running this Sunday night in the 100 metres, if you want to see it get out there. Jen M tweeted to say... now, you kind of identified with the whole injury thing, though, didn't you?
Yeah, well, obviously, like, you've got to feel a bit unlucky, haven't you? Like, after, you know, you've already lost legs and then you get more injuries. Like, I've got an ingrown toe now at the moment. I've got one big toe and it's got an ingrown toe now on it. And you think... For fuck's sake.
Knock it off. Get an upgrade.
Need to get some of those blades.
You're a Scientologist.
Jen N tweeted to say, gutted you won't be running against Johnny Peacock. And then you replied on Twitter, it'll have to be a rap battle. Now, Johnny Peacock is going to be on this show next week, as are you. I mean, would you go head-to-head with an on-air rap battle with Johnny
Peacock? Well, I'm going to have to do something.
Yeah.
So 100%.
Really?
Yeah, let's do it.
The good news is this show has a history of bad rapping, doesn't it?
That's fantastic. I'll keep up the reputation.
What's
yeah,
your...
Yeah, but also, Johnny Peacock is like grown up. You're still a moody kid.
What?
You'll just come out and go... And Johnny Peacock's going, I have bills to pay. People to care for. You might have cut your ear, but you're still that kid living in the basement.
This is, by the way, we should
he
point
is.
Out.
Look at him. This is he's trying to smarten up in his image. It's like he's trying to cop off at 6'4".
Okay, right.
Just quit that. I walked past him and went, Channel 4. Fucking lawyers. I didn't recognise him.
Well, you tweeted before
without
coming...
Without his BMX.
You tweeted before coming here, Londoners, let's do a meet-up, who's keen? Are you...
Do you know there's 10 million of us?
Are you stuck for company?
Yeah, I am. So, why not?
Wow, OK.
Adam, sorry, are you like... Do you mean a meet-up as in, like... A trip to the zoo or like a Netflix and chill meet-up?
A trip to the zoo.
Sounds like a fight club.
Blade runners are not allowed to go to fight club. That's the second rule of fight club.
We did mention Netflix and chill. There are other streaming services available.
Yeah, but nobody watches them.
And it doesn't sound...
I feel I'm not chasing an advert, but they really don't. There's only one main competitor in the marketplace.
But, do catch up with our new series on All 4, the Channel 4 streaming service, which I think is excellent.
OK, Roisin, if I was to say to you, do you fancy coming over for some Amazon Prime and quality time, would that do it for you?
Sure.
Yeah?
Ask me.
Roisin.
What's the alternative to chips and dips?
I don't know. Eye player and a cuddle?
Condom and a shower cap.
Now, here's the other thing. So you also tweeted, by the way, a Tinder bot. A Tinder bot has taken my identity because someone used this photo of you saying, and you said, my name's not Derek, I'm not 6 foot or packing 9 inches. We'll probably get more matches than me.
Oh, that's a
yeah,
shame.
I know. And the worst part about it is that yeah. I can make myself 6 foot, but the other measurement, that's I can't change that artificially. So
upgrade.
Yeah, that's a good idea. That's the real good idea.
Best joke of the night.
What is the 9 inches? Because when I put a certain amount of weight on. All the rest of the fat deposit goes to my testicles. So I can end up packing 9 foot, but accidentally. By eating too much cheese.
The event of the para-athletics kick off.
To put one on the side. I can't do the Charleston.
What?
Some huge events are coming up over the next 10 days. For those of you who remember Rio, even those
Sorry,
of you who don't...
are still talking about Paralympic sport?
Kinda. The women's C44 100
metres... Fatty deposits on your testicles! It's something that needs to be discussed amongst us.
All right, Roisin, this is what I'm taking you to. The women's C44 100 metres on Monday, if you're up for
Yay!
It. Brilliant. It's Malu. Now, watch this. Sophie Camlish from Great Britain is in the lead here. She set a world record during the heats at Rio, but watch Malu van Rijn in the orange come through. She's the double blade. She just pipped her on the post. That is going to be a massively close race Monday night, I believe it is. Now, all weekend at the London Stadium, there's going to be sports as well as free events for the family, street theatre, circus acts, live music. Performances from a group of disabled breakdancers called Illability, one of whom goes by the name of Lazy Legs and performs like this.
I mean, I did wonder why the government were reassessing all the disabled people, but not anymore.
Yeah. Well, during the Paralympics, Johnny Vegas, you had to go to a lot of para sports, but tonight we're thinking maybe para breakdance. Have you... I mean, I'm assuming you've never breakdanced before.
I have breakdowns.
What?
Just a Charleston he can't do.
Don't do that!
What?
You have? You have breakdowns before?
Like breakdowns!
He's acting like Jeremy Paxman! What?
Well, I'll tell you what, in order to
I got a roll of lino for my 13th birthday. So I could go out and do burn-offs.
Sounds like Angela's Ashes.
Well, to try and teach Johnny how to do a decent worm, would you please welcome from Illability, Lazy Legs and Chicho. Hey! You're Lazy Legs? Chicho, good to meet you. Come over here, come over here. Now, this is Johnny. Can you teach him how to do the perfect worm?
You know what? We believe anyone can dance. And my man Chicho's going to show you how to do a worm. And we're going to go for a little dance-off. Does that sound good?
Yeah, good. I'm no stranger to the...
All right. Let's show us.
She thinks I'm talking horse. I've just made that up as a phrase.
Okay, so do you want to show Johnny what he needs to do?
Yeah, go on. And every time I roll, I bang my chin. And go. Let me teach you, Nigel.
We'll be back with more of the Last Leg in a minute as we check out the shape of Donald Trump. Plus, we want you to tweet your Is It OK questions to Southern Rails Work Experience kid Eddie right here, tweeting at the Last Leg. Hashtag Is It OK. We'll see you in a little bit. Welcome back to Last Leg. We're still joined by Johnny Vegas, Roisin Conaty and Liam Malone. I'm very happy to say that the hashtag Eddie Is It OK is currently the top trending hashtag on Twitter. Yeah, and bearing in mind, 13th Doctor is second because of Doctor Who.
Who's the 13th Doctor? Eddie?
No, Eddie is the 13th Doctor.
Also sounds like that Michael Jackson song. Eddie, are you OK?
Is it okay? Is it okay, Eddie?
Don't make him sing!
Jennifer Brissenden said, is it okay that Trump said to Brigitte Macron, you know you're in such great shape? Oh, my God. Right, money in the Trump jar. Donald Trump in Paris said to the French president's wife, I don't have to say it, just watch. She's in such good fit. It was like watching Jabba the Hutt telling Princess Leia she's beach body ready. I mean, okay, Roisin, I'm going to go straight to you. How did that make you feel?
It's bad enough that he said it to her.
Yeah.
But then to say it to her husband as if like she's like he'd found an old Singer sewing machine in the attic. Like, look at this. She's in great shape. It's so rude to talk about someone in the third place. He's just disgusting.
He sounded like he was surprised.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to be minging, but fair play.
That's it.
Yeah, the only way it would have been worse is if he'd gone to Macron. Yeah, I wanted to bang my teacher as well. Totally miss. And also, none of us have mentioned that Donald Trump's wife is stood right there as well. Yeah.
Can you not start a campaign where he goes to a country where he doesn't want to sleep with someone?
I don't think there are
any countries. Married to the president.
Crispin Fish, are there any countries where...
Yeah.
No, it doesn't matter. Pass over it. You did well, though.
Thanks.
Crispin... He looked through me and just carried talking.
Crispin
Fisher
said...
I was like, mate from school has come out and you've made new friends.
Crispin Fisher said, is it OK, is Donald Trump more screwed than a contestant on Love Island? Hashtag fingers crossed. Now, the most ludicrous reality show on TV, a.k.a. The White House, took another plot twist this week. Donald Trump Jr. was accused of meeting with Russian representatives who claimed to have had highly sensitive information on Hillary Clinton that may have helped his father's campaign. Trump Jr. responded by releasing a raft of emails that proved he met with Russian representatives who claimed to have had highly sensitive information on Hillary Clinton that may have helped his father's campaign. For those of you who don't remember Donald Trump Jr., by the way, he's this guy. Yeah, I believe the caption for that photo was Forrest Trump. Do you know what? We were going to do that thing of substituting a different white person in, but we couldn't find any white person that looked as stupid as he did. Trump Jr.'s defence to this whole meeting thing was, yeah, I took the meeting, but they didn't actually have the information they promised. I mean, that's like saying you're innocent of dogging because there was no one in the car park when you got there.
So that was your defence, wasn't it?
Trump's team described the meeting as a nothing burger, but by the look of the guy who set it up, a music promoter called Rob Goldstone, there are a lot of something burgers being consumed somewhere. Here is the guy who set up the meeting wearing a Russian hat.
What?
Here he is reading a Russian newspaper and wearing a shirt that says Russia on it.
He's like the guy that they find... Have you ever seen that show Catfish?
Yeah.
And they'll meet him and go, you're not hot blonde 57.
Hang on, you're not Derek who's 6'9" from Otago. Not only did Goldstone not try to hide the meeting, he checked into it on Facebook. Now, Donald Trump Jr. claims he didn't tell his father about the meetings. Trump Sr. described his son as a high-quality individual, and the Evening Standard ran the headline of the week as they said, Trump Jr., my dad knows nothing.
Bear in mind that Trump Sr. calls everything great, like everything is great.
Yeah.
To only call his son high quality must mean he fucking hates him.
And like the word quality never means quality. It's like the Quality Inn hotel. You know, you go there and it's absolutely dreadful.
Yeah. No, I'd like to think that he's going to eat his son.
We all like to.
If I drive round looking for the butcher shop, I always want to see quality. Donald Trump is a cannibal! I've said it! Send me to jail!
We'll be back after the break as Josh wraps up the last 7 days. We'll see you soon. Welcome back to The Last Leg. We're still joined by Johnny Vegas, Roisin Conaty and Liam Malone. Josh has been keeping an eye on the stragglers of the last 7 days. What do you got?
Would you like to see the least successful attempt ever at putting on a poncho?
Yes.
Everyone, let's... I was told I should talk people through it, but I really feel it speaks for itself.
Oh, this is... I mean, we've all been there. We've all done this at some point. I mean, you're trying to...
I mean... this is...
Oh, that was amazing. Absolutely amazing. Now, Johnny Vegas...
A sequel to Jack Frost.
Johnny Vegas,
didn't have the budget.
I've got a surprise for you, Johnny Vegas. One of our favourite moments in Rio was when you went to watch the wheelchair tennis, wandered in the wrong door, and ended up as a linesman.
Yes.
For Lucy Shuker, the British player. She's here tonight, ladies and gentlemen.
She is.
She's over here, Lucy Shuker.
It's like
Lucy...
surprise tonight, isn't it?
Now, you've been competing in Wimbledon all week. How'd it go?
It was disappointing for me. I lost today in the doubles. But the boys are into the final tomorrow after an epic three-setter today. So the doubles final, all to play for.
Gordon Reid and Alfie Hewitt.
Yes.
And Jordan Wiley's in the final, the doubles final as well.
She's in as well.
Happening over the weekend. We've been asking... We've been asking your Eddie, is it OK questions to send into Eddie, the Southern Rail worker. Eddie can take the... You can probably take the earphones off now. Here are some of the... Well done. I've just been reading through tonight what you've been writing to people. Someone wrote, Eddie, is it OK that you're more trustworthy and likely to give a decent Twitter answer than Donald Trump? To which you wrote back, Kofifi. this is possibly my favourite. Someone said, is it OK that out of you and Josh, you look like the adult? And you wrote back, is it the tash? listen, as this is a para-athletic special, Marcel will be signing the repeat on 4-7. Johnny, one word, just to test the signer. Who's going to be signing this on 4-7? What's the first word that comes into your head?
Four.
Any word. Say a word for a sign interpreter to sign. Go.
You just asked Johnny...
Sorry.
Roisin, quickly.
Lino.
Nice one. Liam, any word?
Wait.
OK, that's all we've got time for this week. Would you please thank our guest, Lucy Shuka? Johnny Vegas! Roisin Connerty! Liam Malone! And one more time for Eddie! And, of course, my co-host, Josh Whittingham! And Alex Brooker! Next week, we'll be joined by Paralympians Johnny Peacock, Hannah Cockcroft, Ellie Simmons, and, of course, Liam Malone's going to be back again to cover more of the para-athletics. You can catch all the action on Channel 4, including Johnny Peacock running the 100 metres on Sunday night, plus the European Women's Football Championships kick off on Channel 4 on Wednesday.
I didn't meet you!
Meanwhile, if you want to see comedians Carrie-Anne Lloyd and Richard Gadd's attempts to interview Donald Trump this week, you can check out the Last League correspondence on All 4. Tonight, though, as we celebrate a week of para sport, we want to leave you with a demonstration of para breakdancing with the dance troupe Ill Ability. Thanks for watching The Last League. My name's Adam Hills. See you next week for the next league.
Screaming cakes are 20 years later. Of course, it does what consciousness does.